My response is that President Trump set out to keep his word to the American people that he would nominate once again a justice to the Supreme Court who would faithfully interpret the Constitution as written. And when you look at the extraordinary body of work, more than 300 opinions of Judge Brett Kavanaugh, you can see the kind of principled jurist who fits right in the model of a Justice Neil Gorsuch, a Justice Antonin Scalia. And I think as people across the country who share the president's vision for the court come to see this good man and see that strong record, that they'll come to the same conclusion.
In 2006, Brett Kavanaugh testified that Roe versus Wade is settled law. You campaigned extensively on the notion that Roe versus Wade should be consigned to the ash heap of history. Are you worried that he's not going to follow what you want to do?
Well, Dana, as you know, I'm pro-life. I don't apologize for it. And I'm proud to be part of a pro-life administration that's advanced pro-life policies. But what I can assure you is that what the president was looking for here was a nominee who will respect the Constitution as written, who will faithfully uphold the Constitution in all of his interpretations of the law.
Do you still want Roe versus Wade to be overturned?
Well, I do, but I haven't been nominated to the Supreme Court.
Right,
I
mean, but you're
Judge
part of the
Kavanaugh
administration
has.
That campaigned, you and the president
That's
campaigned,
right.
saying
right.
you will find nominees to overturn Roe versus Wade. Will you be disappointed if he is given that opportunity and he doesn't? Will you be disappointed?
Well, let me say, as I said, I stand for the sanctity of life. This administration, this president, are pro-life. But, you know, what the American people ought to know is that, as the president said today, this is not an issue that he discussed with Judge Kavanaugh. I didn't discuss it with him either. What we really focused on was the character, the background, the credentials, and the judicial philosophy.
But again, you campaigned so aggressively on finding a nominee who would overturn Roe versus Wade. Do you feel confident? Can you assure the people who voted for you on that notion that this is the man who will do that?
Well, what I can assure people that voted for us is that this will continue to be a pro-life administration. From early in this administration, President Trump has taken decisive steps to advance pro-life values at home and frankly in foreign aid around the world. But what I can also assure people is that the president believes that the proper consideration for a nominee to the court is not about litmus tests. I mean, frankly, we've seen enough of litmus tests over the decades. What we don't want is to have people go to the courts with a specific objective or policy criteria. We want people to go that respect the Constitution as written, will not legislate from the bench.
Right.
And President Trump and I are absolutely convinced that Judge Kavanaugh is exactly the kind of jurist that the American people in the majority want to see on the court.
The president did say that he wanted a litmus test, but let's move on to something else that's going on, and that is at the southern border. It looks like your administration is probably going to miss a court deadline of today to reunite all children under the age of 5 with their parents. If you are going to separate families, isn't it your responsibility as the leader of the government, isn't it the administration's responsibility to figure out how to get them back together?
Yes, and we've been working very diligently in that regard. I think 102 children that were separated from adults, of that number, as of today's deadline, I believe we will have reunited 54 of those children.
But that means that over 50 children under the age of 5, you have children, I have a child, are not with their parents.
Yeah.
Is that acceptable?
Well, it's not necessarily the case.
But should even one child under the age of 5?
Well, what we don't ever want to do is return a vulnerable child, age 3, age 4, to someone who may be a threat to them, who may be a human trafficker, who is not their parent. And frankly, the number has winnowed down from 102 to somewhere in the 70s through our vetting process. We've actually, in this process, found that people who represented themselves as parents turned out not to be the parents. We found out that there were individuals with strong criminal backgrounds that had children with them as they crossed the border.
But Ron Johnson, the chairman of the Homeland Security Committee in the Senate, a fellow Republican, he is very upset at your administration. He said, if they've got a process, they're not revealing it to me. These are human beings.
Well, I spoke to Senator Johnson today, and we're going to continue to work with members of Congress in both parties. Of course, there's a plan. That look, we've got a crisis at our southern border. And when people come into this country illegally, as was the case under the Obama administration, at times when we prosecute people for entering our country illegally, they're separated from their children for a period of time. Those children are dispatched to relatives or to foster care, and we know where they are, and there's a plan to reunite them. But we want to do it in a way that's very careful and very thoughtful. But again, let's not forget, I was in Central America last week meeting with the presidents of El Salvador and Guatemala and Honduras. And I said to them, this exodus must end.
The president, before leaving on his trip abroad today, said he can't answer whether Vladimir Putin is a friend or a foe. What do you think?
President Trump has met with President Putin before, but the meeting in Helsinki will be an opportunity for the president to sit down and I think evaluate the leader of Russia in a fresh way. Look, we've got real challenges across the Middle East. Russia is involved on behalf of the Assad regime in Syria. We have troops in harm's way. Our troops have done a tremendous job destroying ISIS at its source. But finding a long-term solution in Syria will require some agreement and cooperation with
Syria
Russia.
Syria is obviously a big issue, but how is somebody who your own intelligence community says was involved in meddling in American elections not a foe of America?
Well, I think the president's word today was competitor, that he recognizes that Russia and the United States have
competing
interests.
You don't think he's more
interests.
Than that, an actual adversary?
Well, I don't think we have any illusions about Putin or about Russia. But look, President Trump's made it clear. He believes, as he demonstrated when he met with Kim Jong-un, that it's always better to try and talk to people, to try and find peaceable solutions, whether it be on the Korean Peninsula, whether it be with regard to Ukraine, whether it be resolving the issue in Syria. And so I think having the president sit down with President Putin, determining whether or not there's an opportunity for us to find common cause to resolve some of these intractable issues that have been between the United States, and to discuss issues that are of great concern to the
American people. He said it was going to be an easy meeting, easier than the NATO allies.
Well, the president's going to deliver a message when he arrives in Brussels that it's time for our NATO allies to live up to the commitments that they made. The Wales Agreement that they all signed on to said that all of the countries in this important historic alliance would commit to reach 2% of their GDP in defense spending. A very small number of our NATO allies have achieved that number. The United States spends 3.5 to 4% of our GDP, depending on how you reckon it, on our common defense. And it's time for them to do more. The good news is, and I believe the president will reflect this, is that because of President Trump's leadership over the last year and a half, many of our NATO allies are doing more. They're investing more in our common defense. And America and the wider world are safer as a result of a stronger alliance where everyone lives up to their word.